So this will be a bit of a special talk, because I actually have some slides. I will talk a little bit about security at the beginning, but especially at the end of the talk, I would like to make this a real interactive session, because there are some open questions, how to do certain things. And actually, I don't know the answers. So I really hope that also with the feedback together with you guys, we can discuss a little bit what to do here, what the best solution will be to make this like as secure and as good as possible. So it would be good if, I don't know if most of you could come a little bit more to the stage if you want. If you don't, it's also fine. But at least like at the second part of the talk where I have my questions and a discussion part, would be great if you could discuss it a little bit more, because I don't have all the answers here. Okay, let's see if this works. Yes. So my name is Frank Karliczek. I live in Stuttgart. I'm an open source guy for a long, long time. So I was involved in different open source projects at the KDE project for some time. It's close to 20 years now. That's a bit scary. Yes, I'm old. Did all kinds of different things. Probably I'm best well known nowadays to be the founder of OwnCloud and also the founder of Nextcloud. And this is obviously also the main topic here today. So I want to talk a little bit about security in general, why this is important. I want to talk a little bit about the security improvements we did in the last 12 months specifically. So this will be a little bit technical. So there will be a lot of crazy buzzwords, just to warn you. And I'm not pretend to know everything, so it's a complicated area. But I'll explain a little bit what we did here to improve the security. And then the second part, this is like the questions, what we do with updates. And this is where I want to invite everyone to discuss this here as a group, because, yeah, it's an open source conference and you're the experts here. Okay, first a little bit about the Nextcloud mission. So what we're doing is we are file sync and share open source project. So we are basically similar functionality than Dropbox and Google Drive and so on. We also do a lot in the collaboration area, and we also have a lot of communication features. So this is basically what we do. A differentiator of us is that we are 100% open source, so we don't have any proprietary extensions. There is no enterprise edition. There's only one software that everybody can use, 100% open source. And the difference to Google services, Microsoft services, Apple services, is obviously that this is all about self-hosting. So you can take the software, you can put it on any machine you want. So this can be from a tiny Raspberry Pi up to a big cluster for lots and lots of users, everything in between. And then you have your own instance, you have your own little service that you can provide for just for yourself or for your family or for your soccer club, or for your university, or for your big company, or maybe a big service provider. Biggest service provider who works with Nextcloud at the moment has 20 million users, and this is just a small start. They have a little bit more users than that. So really from tiny to really big. The thing is, all of that, all the features, everything we have, absolutely doesn't matter at all if it's not secure. So security is the absolutely requirement for everything. Who cares if the software looks pretty, is fast, has a lot of features? Doesn't matter at all if a hacker can come and break into your instance, read all your files, or do whatever, then this is all totally useless. So security is the absolute baseline of everything, that's the absolute requirement. This has to be secure. Nextcloud has to be 100% secure. Otherwise, it's completely useless. Such a little bit security is not enough. Has to be 100% secure. And that's, of course, a challenge, because actually I had a few conversations like today already. Security is an interesting term because people understand different things behind security. It seems that, just a small side story, it seems that in the US, if you market something like OpenStack, like a private cloud solution, security is not even one of the talking points, because people think that, well, Dropbox is also secure and Google is secure. They have a lot of security engineers, so they have to be secure. And so a private cloud can impossibly as secure. Of course, there are other ways of reading what security is. If you talk with companies here in Europe or in Germany, they think that Dropbox is completely insecure and they have to host it themselves. So there are different ways of security here. Okay, so how do we make Nextcloud really secure? There are lots and lots of things we did over the last 12 months, and I want to go through it. This will be a little bit technical, but hopefully interesting. So the first thing is how, and that's the most important thing, how do you look at security? What is that? Is it something that happens like after the development, all the developers do their happy stuff and do their happy work, and at the end you have a security guy fixing everything? Well, this is not how it works. So security has to be an integrated part of everything. So we see security bugs as technical debt. These are like flaws in the software that has to be fixed. And ideally, I will talk a lot about this in a second, during the normal development process. This is nothing you can just like outsource somewhere and you just have a guy which is security guy and then it is secure. No, it is part of the complete company culture. It's part of everything. Okay, so what we did to achieve that is we basically followed a security process, security development life cycle. This is a term and a process that comes from Microsoft. So Microsoft actually, you might be surprised, is actually a very secure and very good company regarding security processes nowadays after some not so good days from the XP days. But nowadays they actually know what they're doing from the security perspective, not in other areas, but yeah. So this is the security development lifecycle process that we follow, and this is like completely inspired by from Microsoft in this case here. Okay, the first thing is training. So people have to understand what is good and what is bad. So you have to train the people, you have to train the developers, and Nextcloud is an open source project, which means we also have a lot of external contributors. So we have to explain this to people. And there, believe me, there's a lot of interesting stuff. I mean, you learn something every day. So training is important. So detailed documentation about common web security vulnerabilities. So first, like, document everything, how it works, what you can do, what you shouldn't do. And then, of course, well, this is a screenshot of the documentation. And then also do trainings. And this is what we at Nextcloud do as part of our conference. So we have a session, Lukas Reschke, who is our security lead. He's doing regular trainings to tell the people how this all works. And this is super important because, believe me, I mean, I do software development for a while and I learn something every single time I go to those trainings. This is complex stuff. Okay, then the second thing is, I think that the developers have to fix their security issues themselves. I mean, I personally believe that developers should fix every single bug they make themselves. It's not fair that you somehow outsource the fixing to other people, or you outsource, I don't know, the security reviews, and okay, reviews maybe, but actually fixing your code, this is something a developer has to do themselves. This is really important. Because otherwise they don't really learn, right? They make the same mistake again next time. Okay, then the next thing which is really important is, and this is the design phase, you have to understand what your threat model is. You have to understand what that attack surface is. This is really important because security is so, you can understand lots of different things. One example, one decision we made at Nextcloud and also OwnCloud is that an admin has a certain level of trust. So if you have an admin, if you're an admin user of an instance, yes, an admin can shoot themselves into the foot. This is partly understood and accepted. Other things are not accepted. But for example, there are features in the software where an admin can, for example, call an external bash script as part of a workflow, for example, in Nextcloud. And of course, this bash script could do everything, right? It's just a normal script that runs with the permissions of the web server on the server, can do everything. Yes, this can be misused. But in this case, it is accepted that the admin has the power to configure that. And that's really important to understand. What do you want to protect against? And what do you don't want to be protect against? You can't protect against everything. Otherwise, you have a software which does nothing. So that's really, really important to understand this. So we have a real description on our website to describe the threat model, to say what is accepted and what is not accepted for Nextcloud. Good. So now we are in the integration phase. So now we are already writing code. So what is important here? So what we do is we are doing constant checks of the source code. So there are tools like the RIPS scanner, for example. That's a great tool to does static code analysis. So you can basically see if certain patterns are there, if there's a shell exec command or something, and maybe there are even variables passed into the shell exec command. And where do they come from? Maybe they come from external get parameters, really bad stuff like that. So we have automatic scanning that we do here. That's really important. And of course, there are lots of different products in this space, and none of it is covers everything. So unfortunately, the best you can do is to use several tools, and then you probably catch most of the issues. Another thing we do, and I think this is also very, very important, this is a code review process. So no one, absolutely no one from in Nextcloud can just commit code somewhere. That's absolutely not possible. So we have a process. This is also for QA reasons, of course. We have a process where people, where code of people needs to be reviewed by other people. And this is mandatory. There's, you can be the most senior developer. You're not allowed to change anything directly. So we have a review process, which requires that two other people review the code. So overall, there are like six eyes looking at the code. That's really important. Another thing is, maybe a side story or personal favorite topic for me is, I mean, there's a lot of data nowadays in our Nextcloud servers and own cloud servers too, right? There's a lot of interesting data. So we're getting bigger and we're getting more like an attack, a honeypot. Like we're becoming a target for bad guys, basically. So there are people on this planet, I don't know, can be from any country, any organization, doesn't matter. There is a growing interest to put, like, intentionally backdoors into our software. This is just how it is. So we already should think about this scenario and think about what we can do to prevent this. So if you are a hacker from, I don't know, China, doesn't matter. And you really want to have access to all the information that's in Nextcloud all over the globe. You could try to hire a hacker who becomes a community member of an open source project and then puts like a backdoor into it. What can we do to prevent that? And this is not crazy. This is like I said earlier, I was involved in the KDE project. In the KDE project, we had this two times. It is two times where someone intentionally has put a backdoor into it, and we had like crazy people in KDE who were reading every single line of every single commit, and they detected it and it was reverted, and a person was kicked out. So this happens. And of course, something like Nextcloud is a way nicer target for this kinds of stuff. So what can we do? And I think the only thing at the end of the day, what you can do is absolutely 100% transparency for everything. So this is why we have GitHub in our case, which means that every single change from every single person is open, and you can see it, and you can review it, and you can see what's going on. This is also a benefit of Nextcloud, where everything 100% is open source and not only part of it, because you then really have the complete transparency and the peer review process for everything. That's really important. So, and we do this a little bit more sophisticated than just the two reviewers. We also have a bunch of automated unit tests and integration tests and all kinds of other tests, and also security scans there, which are automatically executed once you open a pull request. So once you open a pull request, for the people who would don't know it, this basically means that someone proposes a change in your code. Someone proposes a change. It doesn't just go in. It has to be reviewed by other people, and all these automatic tests has to be executed, and only then it's accepted. This is absolutely important. This is for overall quality, but specifically security. Okay. Then the next thing, and this is a little bit like language specific. I mean, the server is here written in PHP. And in PHP, it is possible, most programming language, specifically in PHP, that you forbid certain functions. And then if you really want to use them, you have to basically, with a markup in the source code, has to enable them. And this is for specific functions, also certain frameworks that we use. An example is if you really want to do like unserialize, or you want to do non-prepared SQL statements, or some other things that are basically, well, if you see this code, it already smells fishy, so that's not really good coding style. And now if you do something wrong, then you can get an SQL injection or something. And this is still possible, but then a developer explicitly has to say with a markup in the source code, and I think I have an example here. Is it here? Yeah, here's an example. Like on the top here, in the top here you have here some markup where you say, okay, this file actually wanted to use a session, and this one to have an access token. And only if you do that, then it actually works. If you don't put it specifically in there, then this is disabled. So a developer who does this, who uses this functionality that are potentially malicious, has to explicitly say, yes, I have a good reason to do this here, and only then it's enabled. So then we have the software written, and it's actually released. Okay, what is the next in the life cycle? Well, obviously, the software can still have bugs. And to be honest, it will have bugs. And to be honest, it also will have security issues. It is really, really hard to write a software without security issues. I mean, a lot of people think that if you have software which is more than 1,000 lines of code, it automatically has security issues. So what you need, of course, you have to try to prevent it, but what you also need is a system to deal with it. You need a process to deal with it, to do the right thing here. And this is, I mean, I think this is widely understood nowadays in the industry. Like 10, 15 years ago, a lot of people in management said, yeah, well, easy solution, just don't make any bugs, right? Don't write any security problems, and then we don't have security problems. Nowadays, it's understood that this is really, really, really hard, close to impossible, so don't have any issues. What you need is a process to deal with it. So, one of the big benefits of open source software is that actually everybody can look at the software. Like, and this is what we use here. So there is a nice website called HackerOne. This is something we use for our bug bounty program. Bug bounty program means that we basically try to attract white hat hackers. Hackers who have some knowledge on how this works and can understand what security problems are, but they don't want to. They want to be the good guys, right? So what do they do? They report it to the software vendor, and the software vendor has, as part of a responsible disclosure process, has the opportunity to fix it, release a patch, and then of course disclose it later. But basically, does everything that helps the user to be safe. Right, and so we have a process for that. And to attract more of those good kind of hackers, and not so much of the bad kind of hackers, sometimes a bug bounty program is used, which means you actually get money from us if you find a security problem. So this is a screenshot here. This is an example. HackerOne is like a very well-known platform. I think it might be the biggest at the moment. It is used by big companies, Yahoo, Twitter, Adobe, General Motors, Uber, Dropbox, and so on. And it's a long list. So there's a shared understanding that this is the best way to deal with this kind of thing. So you can report a security issue, and if this is like understood and accepted as a real thing. I mean, sometimes people report something stupid, that's not how it is, but if it's a real thing, you actually get some money. This is, by the way, important, because we have to understand that there's an active black market for exploits. And depending on the software, and depending if it's already patched or not, if it's a zero-day exploit or not, there's actually a big market for that. So if you, for example, find a problem, that you might have a remote code execution at, I don't know, like Windows or macOS, this is like a seven-figure money, a dollar money that you can get if you sell this to some, on the black market to someone, right? So you actually, the temptation to do this is high. You have to be, you have to be a good guy to say, no, I don't take this $1 million. I report it to Microsoft and don't get any money. That's better. So that's the challenge. Because of that, we also have to basically pay some money so they actually report it to the software vendor, not to someone else. And this is why also the amount of money, the size of the bounty that you get is actually important. And this is like what we have here at the moment with HackerOne. You see Nextcloud here. I mean, we are still a small company, but it's more or less okay with 5,000 euros, dollars, sorry, that we pay here. I mean, it's already higher than the Apache web server. Dropbox is still higher there, still a little bit bigger than us. We are working on that. But 5,000 is okay. So 5,000 is okay, so we give an incentive to the people to report an issue to us. This is the management in HackerOne here, where you see that we have several people, have a full team working on that, reviewing that all the time, so that we are really responsive. So here you can see, by the way, that we have a response time of 5 hours. So 5 hours is the time before someone gets feedback if this is a valid security issue or not. So this is quite fast. We are one of the fastest here, and this is very important. I have to say that, of course, we get a lot of reports that are not valid. So for example, we explicitly say that our bug bounty program is for our software, which is like the server and all the clients, but it doesn't cover like WordPress, where our website runs on, or a distribution which we use for, I don't know, the forum or something like that. So this is about our product. And we got a lot of reports. I mean, there are people who just run like an automatic script, some script kiddies, and then they detect, I don't know, something that, I don't know, a WordPress installation for one of our websites is outdated, and then they come to us and say, okay, now give me money because I detected that your WordPress is not up to date. Well, that's not the purpose of that. But we got a lot of good reports, more about this in a second. So this is a bit of a statistic of the activity at HackerOne, where you can see how it what happens when we launched that. So we launched a program here. We got a big spike, and then it basically flattened out because, well, lots of the people were just report something because they try. Maybe they get some money. They give up and they see, okay, we are really serious here and really reviewing that. Okay, what happens if something is really detected? And we get like reports from people who there are real reports behind it. It's not everything is wrong. So we pay them the money, obviously. And then our normal process starts. So what we have here is that we obviously fix the issue in our code. The important thing is that you usually fix it in a way, I mean, as I said before, we are completely transparent. You can do everything, see everything on GitHub. So you want to fix it in a way that not everybody sees, understands what's going on. You can have to basically, you don't want to disclose it at that point in time. So you fix it without telling anyone what you actually fix here. Then the next thing you do is you release it. Obviously, you release the fix. So we're doing regular patch releases. So every few weeks, there's a new dot release, and then you release a new version which fixes this vulnerability. And then 2 weeks after the fix is released, we disclose it. So every vulnerability is publicly disclosed. It's very important. So we tell the world, look, there was a problem here in this Nextcloud version, and it affected this version, and this is how you can use it, like full transparency, but the fix is already out at least 2 weeks before that. So people have the chance to update their server, and then they are safe. So you might ask, why tell the world how to hack a non-patched version? And I think 10 or 15 years ago, people might ask, wouldn't it be better to just not talk about it? So security by obscurity. So nowadays it's really publicly accepted that you really should be completely transparent. Transparency creates trust. Transparency creates like people can look at the code and see, okay, this prevents against this kind of attack, doesn't prevent against this other kind of attack. So transparency is absolutely key in my opinion. This is why we disclose everything. And I think every major software vendor on this planet does this nowadays. I mean, I don't know about Oracle, but most others, they actually have like security advisories where they say, okay, this patch actually fixes these problems. Okay, so this is a screenshot from our website, the security advisories. There you can see that this is an issue here, content spoofing in the Files app, for example. There you can see the risk level. This is a low level. This is completely clearly defined, what we see as low, medium, and high here. Then we have the reference. So there's a full reference to the original report. There's a description, obviously, right? We have to explain what it really is. We have to say which software is affected, because not every vulnerability affects every software. So it sometimes depends certain versions only. And of course, we also give the acknowledgement, so give the people full credits. So the people who find something also get full credits here. Here in this case, in the security advisory, but also on our general website, we have a credit section where we give the people credits additionally to the money payout that we do. So this is what I already mentioned. Everything is disclosed 14 days after it's fixed, and this is usually called the responsible disclosure process. So this is like the industry best practice. Okay, so now some statistics, how this all worked. So these are the vulnerabilities over the years. There were still some graphics from the own cloud times here, but this doesn't matter, the trend is, you can clearly see that the trend on both projects basically goes down. So this, what we are doing here is getting better. So we're finding less bad things. And this is the same for a server, for the community apps in total. So we're actually doing a good job here. The world is better. You could say that we should have reached the zero line by now, working on that. But things are getting better. So you can already also see, if you look at the vulnerabilities itself, you have low, medium, and critical. And here you can see what is discovered internally and externally. And if you compare this over time, so you can basically see, maybe it's hard to see, that it actually goes down. And the second thing you can see here is if you look at the critical part here, the critical issues here, 2014, 2015, no, I don't have something for last year, but it's similar. You can already see that nothing was found externally. But this is quite good. So our software is now so good that it's really, really, really hard for external people to actually find critical vulnerabilities. So that's good news. Okay, so this was just the security process overall, which I think every serious software project should follow. Of course, this is all relatively defensive, right? So we're trying to protect against issues. Of course, we also do active things, active improvements to improve the overall security. So now I go over a few things, features that we implemented to actively make Nextcloud better. So here we have the content security policy that we implemented. This is a special browser feature. The problem is it's not supported by every browser, but it's a feature where the browser, you can basically tell the browser with certain metadata that certain things like shouldn't be accepted. This helps against cross-site scripting specifically. The basic idea is that if you somehow manage to put like inline JavaScript into your HTML code, you can do this sometimes by not sanitizing forms properly or other things, then this JavaScript code could do certain things like, for example, take the session cookie and email the session cookie to someone, and then I get your session cookie and then go to the website and then I'm logged in as you, for example. This is something that's prevented by content security policy. So this is not actually a fix, this is a hardening which basically makes if you make a mistake somewhere else, it doesn't matter because we have a second safety net, basically. So this is first implement, relatively new feature, first implemented 2013. Dropbox also is implemented 2015, a little bit later. this really helps. Here's just an example. It's basically inline, inline JavaScript, as I mentioned before. And yeah, if you execute this, you get a pop-up. And then, yeah, pop-up is always the example. Of course, instead of a pop-up, you can also email your cookies and your credentials to a hacker. Strict header policies is similar. This is also something we send in the header to the browser to tell the browser what to allow and what not to allow. This is also prevents against certain JavaScript injection attacks that are very popular. The problem here is that it's sometimes not supported by every browser. So here you can see that while Firefox and Chrome are really good, Internet Explorer not so much. Interestingly, Edge also. So this depends a bit on the browser that you use, but it's actually not important because it doesn't create any problem. So if the browser doesn't support it, well, then this user of this browser is not protected against this attack. That's okay, but you can still use it for the browsers that support it. Same side cookies is the same thing, so you can control who has access to the cookies and who doesn't have access to the cookies. Also very, very important. This is just a debug screen where you can see that, yeah, some cookies are set as lax and some as strict, which means you can protect who has access to the cookies. This is, for example, used if you have remote content embedded. If you, have a remote image, for example, embedded in your page, and then this image might have access to the cookie of the other domain or not. But this is something you can control there. Another thing I want to mention, which is really, really important, is Nextcloud is 100% open source. Because if you remember, a lot of things I mentioned before, like with the review process, with the HackerOne bug bounty, with the way to audit the code, with the way to have peer reviews, have complete transparency over the full Git history and so on. Obviously, all those things only work if you're open source. If it's not open source and this is software development is not transparent, happens somewhere else, then this is a problem. I mean, I don't have to convince you, I guess. It's an open source conference here. Just want to mention that it's actually very important that you don't have any proprietary code in your application. Otherwise, you don't know what happens in this part of the application. Okay, then some more functionalities we implemented. First is a two-factor authentication. The first version was already released last summer, and we improved this over time. So at the moment, we support out-of-the-box, support time-based second factor, and SMS gateway if you want to. That's something you usually don't have at home, but some bigger organizations want to use that. An example is for the time-based two-factor, the standard, the TOTP standard. There is an implementation from Google, for example, in the form of Google Authenticator, which is available for Android and iOS. Don't have to be afraid. This is nothing really to do with a Google account. It doesn't send anything to Google, but it's a free application that you can use for that. But there are also other implementations. But Google is the most used one. So you can just enable it, go to the Nextcloud apps page, click on the app, and then it's enabled. You install this app on your phone, and then you have two-factor. Everybody can and should use that. There's no reason to not use it. Two-factor is really easy and really good. The second thing we did in the summer and improved in Nextcloud 11 and again improved in Nextcloud 12 is brute force protection. So this is something really important because Nextcloud has some public API endpoints, so it has a WebDAV interface, it has some REST endpoints, and with just a simple script, I mean, this is like, I don't know, 3 lines of bash code. Obviously, you can just like do a dictionary attack and try standard passwords against an instance, and then if you have a fast internet connection, you can test quite some passwords in some time. And that's obviously a very common, very easy way to find weak accounts from users who, who don't understand what a good password is. And for that, we implemented the brute force protection directly inside Nextcloud. You can also use this with firewalls and with load balancers and kind of other things, but not everybody has a dedicated firewall. So this is why we put it directly into Nextcloud. So it basically throttles the request. If you have a few requests over time, a few wrong login attempts, then it becomes slower and slower. You might have seen this from other software too. Another feature is this file access control, where you can configure who has access to which file, from which LDAP group, from which IP, from which device, and so on, which is also available for Nextcloud, completely open source. It's just with one click downloaded from our app store. A few more specific things, Nextcloud 11, which we released last December, we implemented app-specific tokens, specifically the advanced feature to allow to restrict file access control. So you can say that one client, for example, the client for the RSS reader or one client for your calendar, can access your Nextcloud account to read your calendar, but it doesn't have the permission to access your files. So the calendar app can only access the calendar, but not the files. So this is something we implemented, implemented Kerberos authentication. We have a password confirmation for sensitive actions. So basically on the admin page, if you do certain things that are security relevant, for example, you disable two-factor, you first have to type in your admin password before you're allowed to do that. We use HTTPS by default for everything, specifically Federation. This wasn't used before. We have a password reset logic where you have to validate your email address first and so on, so it makes it more secure. The brute force protection, as I mentioned before, for WebDAV and the endpoints. Content security policy 3.0, this is like the most modern one that exists at the moment. Same site cookie fully supported, security holdings and Collabora online, and so on and so on. We also implement like signature and checksums for a lot of things. So if you download an app from the Nextcloud App Store, every app from us is signed and the signature is checked. The signature is done by a certificate which is owned by the developer, which is then countersigned by us. This is a full cryptographic correct way of distributing software. So this is really nice. With Nextcloud 12 that we just released, like, was it this week? Yes, what, this week? Time is moving fast. So this week we released Nextcloud 12, also with additional functionalities. So new ways to authenticate our clients. There's a new, complete new workflow for that, which makes integration of other authentication ways better. The brute force protection is now basically implemented for all APIs, and there's also a rate limit. I just learned that there's a difference between brute force protection and rate limits, because rate limits is more to prevent against spammers. So, for example, a feature of Nextcloud is federated sharing. So you can invite other people to accept a share from me. And this is something you probably don't want to basically get like 10 invitations per second from someone. So there's a way to limit this and limits it automatically. Support multiple access tokens, support for NFC two-factor authentication, very nice feature. OpenID support, OAuth support directly built in, CAS authentication support. So really a lot of improvements. So we invest a lot of time, a lot of energy into making Nextcloud really secure. And I think we are making really good progress. But of course, it's only our opinion. So for that, we asked a security company, the NCC Group, last year, end of last year, after 11, to look at our processes and our code, and they did a full audit and full review and actually gave us really, really nice notes. You might say, well, this is clear because we pay them. Well, if you look at the website, they also rate other people sometimes not so good if they're not so good, and they give us really high notes. So it seems that we're really in a good shape here. Okay, so this was the first part of my talk. So I'm sorry if I completely killed you by the buzzword bingo here. we're trying to do a lot to make a Nextcloud instance really, really secure. And now I want to move to the second part, which I hope is a little bit more interactive. So I want to invite everyone to interrupt me, and I will also ask you questions to discuss this, because for this part, I actually don't have all the answers. So this is a little bit more interesting. Okay. So the first thing I wanted to say is that we really do huge investment to make this open source file sync and share as secure as possible. As I said before, this is the full goal of everything. This is when I started like this private cloud stuff like 7.5 years ago, this was the full idea of making it as secure as possible. So that's the goal. You can do whatever you want. If you have a security vulnerability, if you can remotely access all the files, then everything else is useless. So that's the goal. So, as I said before, we try really hard to not make any mistakes, but our software is written by humans, not by robots, so we make mistakes. So what do? If you have a mistake, you follow our process, and we provide the patches, and we have to encourage the people to apply these patches, because it's really hard to fix something without changing it. Obviously. So we fix things, we improve things, we move forward, but people really, really should use the latest version in general, the latest major version, which would be ideal because it has the most hardenings, but specifically, even if they decide to stick with an old version, that's also totally fine, but then they really should apply the latest patches, the latest security patches. That's super, super important. So you might say, yeah, security, there are some esoteric ways, some evil hacker, if they're really clever, doesn't matter. I'm just my own little instance. It's fine. This whole security thing is totally overblown. They are just like people who want to be important. It's not so critical. Well, if you actually look at our website, at our advisory section, we have this is like zoomed here. This is not everything. But we actually disclose a lot of security issues here. They have different severity. Some are low, some are medium, but some are high. For example, remote code execution. There actually were a few, like, I don't have the statistics here, but there is a remote execution problem. I don't know, if you look over the whole history, at least once a year. And you can say, that's bad, work with better developers, do something else, pray, I don't know. But this is how it is. There are security problems. And a remote code execution means if I know the URL of your server, with one script, I can execute code on this server. I don't know your username, I don't know your password, I know nothing. So I only know your URL, and I can somehow execute code on the server. Executing code on your server obviously means having full access to all your data, and also have access to more information that might be somewhere else on your server, depending on which user you use. So this is the absolutely worst case. Other things that happen are security bypasses, that you can somehow access things without knowing the right credentials. Obviously very bad, it depends on how it exactly works. Might be not as bad, might be sometimes you have to know the username or other things, depends. Cross-site scripting is something that usually works if you email someone a link, you click on a link or something, and then you somehow have access to the files of this user. And there are also other things like bypass, other things like the permissions, like the quotas, other things that shouldn't happen. As said before, you could say, yeah, Frank, it's just like Nextcloud is shitty, learn how to program. Interestingly enough, there are some other examples. I mean, you all heard of WannaCry. This is like done this by this small, totally unexperienced software company called Microsoft, which has in fact a remote code execution. This is what it is, what I described earlier. So from remote, you can execute code on this operating system. Interestingly enough, they actually have a similar problem. So they actually had a patch, but no one applied it. Also partly because it affected XP and this was out of maintenance. This is some other discussion. Don't want to get into that. But there is an issue which is like known for a while. People didn't apply the patch and you have like millions of computers like compromised. Another thing is Samba. I think this was disclosed like 2 days ago or something. If you're one of you runs a Linux box with Samba, update your Samba package, remote code execution. Same thing. And same thing can also happen for Nextcloud, and it happens from time to time. So update your software. That's really important. This is where it gets interesting. So there are different philosophies here, right? There are sometimes, and this might, I don't, no problem with Debian here, but I will mention them a few times here in this talk, because this seems to be the distribution who has the highest focus on stability. And which, what I mean with stability means don't change the code. This is of course a problem if the code has security issues. There are like some policies, they all should be backported, sometimes they're not backported. We did some statistics, and the Debian packages actually didn't backport like 80% of our fixes, so might be stable, but might be not really safe. So it's stable and safe is not the same. So what we really need is a way to update the software if a security issue is discovered. As I described earlier, we have the responsible disclosure process that we follow. We have a 2 weeks window. So if there's a patch released by the software vendor, you strongly recommend that you apply this patch in 2 weeks. Otherwise, it might be disclosed by the software vendor, and then everybody, also the bad guys, can see what security issues exist somewhere and might use them. So, what can we do, and what do we do to motivate people to apply those patches? Has someone an idea what we as a software vendor can do that people update their instances, apply a patch? Make it not break things. Good point. I come to back to. Sorry. Yeah. First to this point. Yes. Don't break things. Yes, this is one of the most common issues we heard over time. This is also a reason why we completely rewrote the updater for Nextcloud. And according to all the feedback we get and the bug reports, it works like super reliable. And yes, it shouldn't break things. And to your point, update them automatically. Yes, I come back to this in a second. This is my last slide. This is also an open question. If we should actually apply patches automatically without asking the user or not. What else can we do? Should we do? Should we even care? Publish? Proof of concept. Yeah, but this doesn't work because we publish the proof of concept and the details only 2 weeks after we release the patch, and by then hopefully people have updated. Otherwise we have the same than the who was it? The Drupal apocalypse, where they basically released one blog post, say, by the way, all your instances are insecure, have a good day. And then people obviously had no time to fix it. So we. Yeah. So yes, part of the disclosure is sometimes proof of concept, where you can actually see how an issue is used. But by then, people should have been updated already, because then it might be too late. That's the problem. So yeah, yeah. Other ideas what we could do? Okay, so we discuss this all the time and we think about it really hard because, as I said before, the mission of Nextcloud is to make the people more secure, to make them safer so that they don't lose any data. That's really important. That's the most important thing for us. So what we do is several things at the moment. We have on our admin page, we have a warnings section where we tell people to we basically, the instance checks itself is correctly configured, and we warn the admin, look, there is something wrong. Maybe there's an Apache setting wrong, or there's something else wrong, and we tell the people, look, this is something that you should fix. And this is a link to the documentation. This is how it works. Second thing is we have update notifications, which means the Nextcloud server pings an update server from us from time to time. And if the update server says, look, there's a new version available, this is shown to the admin, there's a new version available, you really should update. By the way, now with Nextcloud 12, we support like push notifications to the phone. So basically 2 seconds later, your phone will beep and tell you, you really should update your server. And this is a new feature of 12. So we tell the admins that, that they really should apply the latest fixes. Another thing we implemented for Nextcloud 12 is we have an additional way of pushing information to the user. There's a way to push news and better announcements, all kinds of things to our users. So we have basically, it works like an RSS feed. We have an RSS feed, a special one on our website, and the Nextcloud service pulls this, and if there's a new message, it shows to the admin this message. So this is a way to talk to our admin, even if there's no update. So we can push out warnings and all kinds of other things. And as discussed before, we completely rewrote the Nextcloud updater. So it works super reliable now. All these problems from the past where sometimes your instance is broken, this really shouldn't happen anymore. Okay. So, oh yeah, one more thing about the update notification, by the way. This is not, I want to ask you too. This is an interesting question. So our colleagues from Debian, again, sorry if I pick them all the time, but yeah, this is what they are. They decided that actually Nextcloud pinging the Nextcloud update server and looking through new versions, that this is a calling home feature. So they patched this out. So if you use a Debian package, you actually have no idea that your instance is totally outdated and that there is no new version and actually that it has a serious security problem. Yeah, that's true. So the theory is that they should use the Debian package management and there's always an up-to-date package there and everything is good. This is just not a reality. So for a long time, they shipped a version that was totally outdated and full of fully documented security issues. And after quite some discussions with them, we convinced them to actually remove it from the repository because this was really, I mean, this is all not a joke, right? It's like this version had like 10 different ways for remote code execution, fully documented for years. And I mean, I don't blame them, it's a volunteer project. Of course, no one had time to update it or backport the fixes, but that's just how it is. So that's a problem. Okay. So it was sort of clear for some time that not every user updates all the time immediately. This is what you hear from people, from the internet, from all kinds of sources. People run like old software. The question is if this is like a big number of users or a small number of users, but different, some really don't update their instances all the time. So,
yeah, I just have a question about Debian.
Yeah.
Since you're just complaining about Debian, do you actually have a Debian repository where people can have a Debian package that they can just access and then have it updated through a Debian process?
Yeah, that's a good. First of all, I want to say don't blame Debian. It's a great project, great operating system, community driven, nice people. I talked with them many times. The question with our own repository, that's a good point. we don't have this, by the way, hopefully have it in the future. But even if we did, it was in the main repository from them and not maintained. Yeah, I should hurry, yeah. So that's the challenge, right? I mean, if it's, yeah. Okay. So basically it was clear for a long time that not everybody updates. So end of last year, we rewrote our new updater, as I said before, and we looked at the logs, who updates when, what, how often. You can see this partly. Then we thought, okay, well, this is like a lot of people really don't update. So more than expected. So then we basically said, okay, we should really check this. So how many people are actually affected here? And this is why we used not our own scanner. This is like a misconception, but there are actually scanners available on the internet where you can basically scan instances, not done by us, but other systems. And this is, by the way, nothing that Nextcloud basically only does, right? This is not, you don't have to be an evil hacker for that. This is fully documented. Everybody can do it, and you can be sure that a lot of people do that. And what we basically did together with this other project is to take a look at the instances out there. And what we found is that 2/3, and we scanned around 80,000 instances, and scanning, by the way, scanning also, I should explain what scanning means. Scanning means go to the URL and look if there's a stages.php file where you then can see if there's an instance, and if yes, what's the version number. And we did a little bit of magic that if it's not found in the root folder, we also looked into like /nextcloud or something. And that's all we did. That's all we did. From those 80,000, obviously we didn't detect all of those instances, not possible. But from only of those 80,000 instances, 2/3 of those were vulnerable and not in a small way, with serious issues, with remote code execution, with like reading all files from this instance. So that's a thing we basically discovered end of last year. So this is the question now. What should we do? What should have been done? What's your opinion? And another point where I would love to hear opinions from you. What should we do as a software vendor if we discover that? Remember that the whole goal of this whole thing, the whole goal of what we're doing is to provide security to our users. Now discover that like 2/3 of the instances can be hacked. Any opinions what we should do? Sorry? Yeah. I mean, I have to say that, of course, we, as I said before, we do all these notifications, we have a blog, we have our website, we document everything. People who read our website understand that there's an issue, there's a new version that should update, right? This all happens. But people, not everybody is reading our website, which is fine, and they're not following the blogs and ignore the notifications and so on. So what should we do? So basically, I think there were three options. First is like the old school way. This means like, yeah, security by obscurity. Just shut your eyes. No one will find out. It's all fine. This is basically no longer accepted by anyone in the industry. Second option is, okay, we fix it. We fix all the issues. Like I said, we already do this, but we make sure that we fix everything. We supply the updates on the website. And if the users apply those patches, if they install the latest version or not, not our problem. Right? We told everyone, if they do it or not, not our problem. Would be an option. Or the third option, to do something a little bit more active here. And I come to this in a second. So these are basically the three options. May I ask here who thinks that option one is the best? Okay. Option two? Option three? Okay, kind of tiny bit more for three, but a lot of seems to be undecided, which is true. I'm also undecided. Okay, so if we do something, what can we do? Well, write a blog post, you can do that. Sending emails to the people, that's a bit tricky because, well, Nextcloud is a private cloud solution. We don't even know the email addresses of the admins. We can't really send emails. I mean, some subscribe to newsletters and stuff, and we already send notifications over those channels, but we can't send emails to all the admins. The third one, the fourth one here is there a process for that? And it seems that there is actually a process. There was some hype the last few years about cyber crime and cyber warfare and so on, and a lot of stuff happens in the countries, also in Germany, which some of it, it's my opinion, a bit useless, but also there are a few things that are actually useful. For example, there is actually a process for that. So the thing is, there is actually an institution in Germany, and Germany is the BSI, which is like, in the case of Germany, it's like part of the government. But there are other examples like Switch in Switzerland, which is actually a private organization. And there are the certs. Certs has nothing to do with a certificate. Certs means computer emergency response team. C for computer? Yeah. So this is basically the institution, like an institution for a company, for a country, which is like responsible for these kinds of things. And what we did, we got in contact with them and discussed the situation with them, and they actually have a process with that. And the process is, they are actually, they have the authority to talk to service providers, and the service providers then actually then know the customers, and they actually have the email addresses from the admins of the customers. So they can send out notifications to the admin, say, look, your instance is vulnerable. Your instance is like, there are those three documented ways to take over all your complete instance, fix that. Of course, the thing is, this only happens for the 80,000 or two-thirds of those 80,000 instances that we actually detected. There are a lot of that are actually not detected, because it's not possible to scan every single URL on the internet. And because of that, we also work together with them to do press work, to talk about this in public, that people update the instance. So this is what we did. This was a bit painful, and it was actually hard to explain the motivation behind that. Of course, we also want to make things in the, safer in the future.
So you have another 10 minutes, just for information.
Oh, cool. Okay, so we actually can have a discussion. Thanks. So the question is, what can we make sure, how can we make sure that people actually update their instance? That's the most important thing. I mean, we all know that something like Firefox and Chrome that do auto-updates in the future, and already Windows 10 reboots automatically and installs patches. It might be annoying, yes, totally, but at least they are a little bit better patched than XP. And the question is, what can we do as Nextcloud? Should we even care? We can say, there's a patch, I don't care. If people are not secure, it's their problem. Or if we care, what can we do? One thing, I think, is that we really have to work on the way this is packaged and automatically updated. So there is Snap, for example, of Ubuntu. There is the Cubic project I learned here, launched here, which is a great way to keep your software up to date, in my understanding. I think with Cubic, it even like applies patches automatically and even reboots automatically, if I understand correctly. Is this correct? You even Snap does the same thing, a Snap fan. So I think this is a modern way of making sure that software is up to date. The next thing we are considering, to be honest, I'm not sure, we could also build a real auto update in Nextcloud itself. So this is something that WordPress, for example, does. As you know, WordPress had a similar problem like a few years ago where people don't apply patches and then the instances were hacked. So nowadays, a WordPress install can update itself, not to major versions, but can apply certain emergency patches. And this is something, again, where I want to love to hear your opinion, if this is something we should do or not. Because as discussed before, some people like, sorry, the Debian guys again, they really think that software shouldn't even talk home. If you tell them, well, this software actually reads like source code from the internet and changes over time, that would go crazy, right? This is completely against the philosophy. And of course, also Nextcloud is a security project. I mean, this is like, do you want us as project push code to the servers of all of you? And that's a question. That's the last open question. So is any opinions? Should we do this or not? No?
I think there are two sides of it. On the one hand, I would like this auto update as you have it, for example, for Firefox on certain operating systems.
Yeah.
On the other hand, if you're looking more at the enterprise level where Nextcloud is positioned,
yeah,
it will definitely come in the wrong place, and you have to make sure that the admin restarts the service afterwards.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's a good feature. It can only work about information. So maybe you can offer an easy way, maybe from the admin front end, to subscribe to security mailing list with just one click, that you get make sure you have the email address of the admin and you can reach them with the security advice.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, we have this already, but maybe we can integrate it better. Yes, that's a good point. Talking about the enterprise, what you mentioned, yes, I think the enterprise is a little bit different. Yes, in enterprise, you want to have like planned maintenance windows and so on. You don't want to have like services restart automatically. So, if I understand correctly, also the Cubic project, you have some kind of management interface where as an admin, you can schedule when something happens and when not. So this is something obviously we would need too for the enterprise. But for the use cases, and we actually have like millions of instances where people don't really have a full-time admin, then this would be for that.
Yeah, I think for cases where it's packaged, for example, like an OpenSUSE where I install from packages, I certainly don't want, I want my RPM minus V to show the packages unchanged. So providing timely updates and maybe telling people with I'm not sure if subscribing to a mailing list is nowadays still fancy with many people because you get lots of email and nobody reads them anymore. But maybe some feature like having a simple RSS decoder in the admin interface or even the user interface. Actually, not only the admin see it because I never log in as an admin into my cloud.
Yeah.
So that. Very, very simple RSS feed with only important messages.
But we have this already. You get a notification in the interface.
Yes.
And like in the future also like push to your phone and to your client, desktop client makes Bing there's new version of the server first available. We have this already until 2/3 of the instances were not updated.
Okay, yeah, but then there's that will probably be people who also do not enable the auto update feature or something like that. Because I mean if you're not patching your installation, if you're actively not patching, you cannot avoid this probably. Maybe somehow like pinging home, and if you find it's really vulnerable, shutting down or stuff, and it's also not a good way. But something like that would be the only thing that would convince people to patch more often, so making it stop working.
Yeah. Thanks.
Just a comment about auto updates. For example, if you look at Google Chrome. For Debian, they drop a repository link for apt-get, and you just apt-get, and you get a new version whenever it's available.
Yeah.
You can do the same with zipper-dup, and fine. And that way you keep track of which files are managed by which packages, and you don't just overwrite them randomly. And it's I think, the preferred method.
Yeah, that's true. We could like distribute this via native packages. That's true. Of course, people still then have to execute apt-get update. If they don't do this, then
So you probably know my opinion, but I'm going to twist the question around. So what can you do if your goal is to provide secure software to people and they're not enterprise admins reading email over weekend because it's security CVE?
Mm.
Well, what can you do? And Snap's auto update, I think that's the only safe thing to do. Institutions, give them a knob to turn it off or control it, but normal people don't understand the problem. And you're asking them, what's the preferred solution? I think the question is different. There's no question of how we should we update? It's just how we apply the update.
Yeah.
So the only way to make it, you said it yourself, to change the software to make it better. You have to change it. There's no way to fix it without changing it.
That's true. Yeah, that's totally true. And there's another area, by the way, where there are also no enterprise admins, which is the whole IoT stuff, right? There's no enterprise admin for your light bulb, right? There's no one is doing a maintenance window for your light bulb. It should happen automatically. That's the only solution.
But just a word about the auto updates things is kind of myth. For example, you don't know how I install Nextcloud, and you don't know how I use it. So you don't know when it's the best time to update it,
yeah.
And what kind of requirement I want to have before an update happens. So, yeah, except giving more space for communication to people to try to make them aware that they should update. But yeah. Mostly it will not be only Nextcloud to be updated. There is certainly Apache CV, kernel CV, and so on. So
right.
It's a global communication message we have to do about Flow software.
It would quite be a workload, but if the Nextcloud installation notices that it has older version and there are already security issues, you could download some kind of scanner for artifacts which hints for hacks. So you could say, okay, you're already hacked, you should update. Yeah, but it's already a hint, but it could work because people only do something if they know somebody hit them.
Connect your backup disk now because
and please make auto update and notifiers configurable because this is something which is important, but in enterprise installations it's often deal breaker.
Yeah. Thanks. I think we don't have any time. Yes, thank you. Thanks a lot.